And then when they introduce a person who combines knowledge, passion, and engagement, and we saw it already in action twice, and you know already maybe what I'm talking about. She lost life since she was a little girl. And this is simple enough. It's a driving force for radical life extension. Yes, I talked about Maria Atreides Abramson. She's an Argentinian American singer, actress, composer, and talent. How about that for a unique combination? She's also a public speaker and an activist in the life extension field. Maria believes in the radical change and spends her colorful life in giving talks on health and longevity, singing for thousands of people, composing, acting in a Hollywood film or flying an airplane. She is currently SENS Foundation's Global Outreach Coordinator and lives in LA with her husband Gary. Please re-welcome to the stage Maria Atreides Abramson.
Thank you. What a great presentation for a woman. I didn't think he was talking about me. Wow. She exaggerated. Okay. So I want to talk to you about a realization that I had only a few weeks ago. I've been working towards ending aging for many years now, doing fundraising, outreach, development, public relations, all kinds of things. And I had to learn to explain. Justify and even sometimes to apologize for wanting to end aging. A lot of people will come to me and ask me a lot of questions, and sometimes it became really hard for me to explain why I'm doing this. And it should be such a simple answer. You will think that, but then I'm sure you found yourself struggling too sometimes, trying to explain why you want to do this. So I get interviewed because, of course, I'm this weird person who's trying to cure aging, and I'm also a paralysist, so I'm going to be frozen when I die. But people interview me to see what's in my head, why I'm doing what I'm doing. And I had a realization. So for many years, I've been giving talks and talking about data and statistics and talking about the social implications and the ethics of this and trying to, in a way, you know, convince people why this is a good thing. And I'm getting really tired of trying to convince people. So I had this realization early. I felt comfortable trying to answer the question for the first time. I'm usually eager and passionate, and I wanna change people's minds about it. So there was this film crew that came all the way from Europe to Los Angeles, where I live with my husband, to interview me, and they came to spend a day with me, actually 2 days, one day in LA, one day in Scottsdale, where Alapur is, to see what I do, what I eat, what supplements I take, and that's all good, and I appreciate the interviews. This is great, and I'm thankful for that, and these are wonderful people. She was a big celebrity, she has a great show in Europe. So they flew all the way and spent a couple of days with me, and I cooked breakfast. They came to the kitchen and saw me cooking my breakfast and wanted to see what kind of food I eat. And so, you know, I prepared my eggs and my tomatoes and avocado and vegetables. And they were curious about every little thing I do. My husband and I are both very much into what we call extreme health. We want to be as healthy as we can and stick around as long as we can so we get the benefits of the big therapies when they come out, so we reverse aging and, you know, we want. So we study our gene and our genes, and we discover different interesting things about each other, and we adjust our lifestyle, supplements we take, we check our blood markers. So the film crew was with us, and we went to the lab. I was getting my blood drawn, I was checking my folate levels, and tend to drop this gene mutation I have, and I supplement. So every 2-3 months we do blood testing, and we check and make sure that everything's fine, and we keep making changes. So it was great, you know, she was curious about everything and asking me all the details. Then we went back home, and we sat at the dining table, and she sat by me, and I saw that she was signaling the cameraman to come closer to me. So he got really close to me, and then she disappeared. And what was going on? And then she puts her elbow on the table. She looks at me and says, "Why?" Why? She says, "Why are you doing this?" And that was the moment that I had this realization that I want to share with you today. So I said, why am I doing this? So then, you know, I started thinking, and everything was going really fast, right? It wasn't really second, but all these thoughts were, was a strong thought in my head. Because I have all these answers, right, that I'm always given. You know, aging is bad because, you know, it brings disease, and we spend $40,000 a second trying to make people feel better with geriatrics and gerontology, but all we do is we ameliorate the symptoms, and we don't cure anybody, and the healthcare system cannot sustain this anymore, and you know, we fall apart. I have a lot of data that I give, that I've given in most of my talks, and so all this stuff came to my head, and it was the answer that I was prepared to give, like I always do. But for some reason, this time I felt different. Something shifted in me, and I said, no, I can't be being asked this. It's not possible. She's asking me, why am I doing this? So then I thought, this, what part of this are you talking about, right? This is inside my head quickly, while she's still looking at me. This, you mean the part of that I want to be really healthy? Or you mean this, the part that I don't want to get super sick and lose my body's functions, my bone density, my muscles, and my memory, and pee my pants, and just become decrepit and suffer a lot? Or what part of this are you talking about? That this that has to do with that I want to die? Because, wait a minute, do you want all this stuff? Do you want to die? Death? Death is the worst word we have in the dictionary. Death is big, right? I mean, we all know death is, isn't it the worst thing? But the whole world knows this is not. This, like always says, there's a psychology problem, right? Because it's not that people don't know this. Death is the worst news you can hear. Somebody died, someone you love. It's the worst thing you can hear is somebody died. There was a shooting. 30 people died, a terrorist attack, people died. The worst ending of a movie, the worst ending of a book, the worst thing you can wish to somebody. It's always dying, it's death, right? So she's asking me, why are you doing this? And then this that I'm doing has to do with pain, disease, and dying. And I wonder, is there anything worse than those three things? There's nothing worse than that. So why am I having to explain so much about this? So I wanted to ask her, it's like, you know, if I was asking you why don't you want to be in prison, or why don't you want to be tortured, or so something happened inside of me, and I felt that I didn't have to answer this question the same way anymore. And of course, you know, I represent an organization, and you have thinks that this is a bad thing, they don't get it, I will not change their minds. And I know a lot of people say the opposite, that we have to work really hard to make people think about this and change their minds. I worked on this for so many years. I honestly don't think I changed anybody's mind. I haven't. So I cannot be, I can't keep being apologetic and having to explain and justify why I do something so obvious for myself and for the world. And have you ever met people that as soon as you tell them that you want life extension, they get excited and they're like, oh, really? So scientists are working on that. Is that going to be possible? And they get excited. Raise your hands if you found people like that. Right? Okay. There are probably millions and millions of people like that. And those are the people that we have to talk to and spend our time with. Not changing the minds of the other ones that don't want this. And guess what? All those people who say, this is a bad idea, or this is not natural, I think, we're playing dolls. All those people are the same people who dye their hair, do plastic surgery, take pills for other things. When we have the first pill to cure aging, they're going to take it. I'm sure of that. I bet everything I have, they will. So, in the meantime, I decided that I don't have to explain myself, I don't have to justify why I want to be healthy, why I want to get old and fall apart, and why I want to live longer, and I don't have to justify that I don't want to die either. I just don't, and I won't anymore. I won't do that anymore. So, thank you. So when she asked me that, then, and she's there, looking at me, and I'm thinking all these things quickly, and probably smoke was coming out of my ears, and I'm like, okay, well, they have to say the right thing. And then I just paused, looked at her, and I said, you know why? Because I love life. That's it. Thank you.
Before you finish, Maria, can I say this again? I love life the way you say it.
Say it.
I love life.
Come on, you all say it. I love life. That's it. Nothing else. That's what I explained.
Thank you so much, Maria. So, did you get impressed about communicating the do's and don'ts? It was so clear. If you give people a feeling they're valuable, they mean something, and actually listen and take it in, these are the millions we're looking for. And Maria pointed out so clearly, not to waste time with the others. They might be late adopters. Hopefully they live long enough to get it. But here in this room, you are the early adopters. So let's call our panel members back up to stage. And please keep sending this interesting question I see here on my screen. So please keep typing away, because I'm sure you have more than those. So please join me here. Thank you. So first question, does accumulated damage actually mean entropy? In some systems, system repair is faster, so they don't accumulate that much damage to get old. This question probably goes to the first one.
Yes, the biology program to kill themselves, but the easiest way to kill themselves is to just stop doing the routine repair that works so well on your own. So a lot of what happens to us when we age looks like damage, and it is damage. The body is capable of repairing that. We just give it the signals and say, you're young, do your job.
Yeah, thank you. Second question is for Peter. Is it the mechanism of GAN, generative adversarial networks, bringing an important new set of breakthroughs to deep learning?
Yes, I mean, obviously, we're getting into some pretty technical territory here.
gas that they are interested in, interesting technology, but they still don't learn incrementally in the wild from new information, and certainly they don't have a common architecture to be able to reason with that. I think there's some good inspiration from the technology that we can draw on and incorporate into a common architecture. So, yes, I think it is an important improvement.
Thank you. Brilliant question. Number three, how can we measure passion for life?
How can you measure?
I think that was the question.
Passion for life? You hung up with me a little bit. I'll show you.
So I want to ask Peter, the guy playing in Sylvester, do you think that the human brain is, the technical term is a Turing machine? The capacity of the human brain is to do just what a computer does, but maybe we have a longer processing power? Or do you think there's something else that the human brain can do that current computer architecture will never be able to?
I don't believe there's anything that we do cognitively that digital computer cannot do. So, yeah, I believe we can.
No fundamental limitations.
No. And usually the question is, can it be conscious? And yes, absolutely. I believe that it can be conscious. But consciousness will ultimately be very different from ours because we, of course, have our whole body and our emotions and the signals we get from our body.
Thank you. So the next question is reminds me of an Einstein quote that you may or may not know how it was ignored. But the quote goes like this: any problem cannot be solved with the same level of intelligence that created it. And this reminds me really with this question, and that is probably goes to Peter. By dealing so much with artificial intelligence, don't you think your own intelligence improved?
Yes, that's actually a very good question. Actually, I'll go further than that. In fact, I've written about that. That I actually firmly believe that artificial intelligence, as we develop it, will not only improve our own intelligence, but also improve our own morality. To make us better people. So I see AGI as being a very positive force in our lives.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other questions spontaneous from the audience? Now it's time to talk. Oh, it's locked.
That's I have a question for you, Peter. Given the robots, maybe I got distracted, you said that you were showing that were following it. Were they autonomous robots that were, so, because I've seen videos of incredible robots, like, you know, Boston Dynamics, and they do all kinds of jumping, and I was surprised to see this. Was that something I missed?
Actually, you know, that's again goes directly to really what we talk about, the hype of AI, of how much misrepresentation there is, you know, by being what you can do, etc. Now, the Boston Dynamic robot, most of the videos that you saw actually were not controlled.
That's what I was
looking for. It's a person that was making something. Now, they were doing some neat stuff.
You said the site, so.
They were doing some neat stuff, but they're not going to be able to operate. If they've been able to, they were free to compete in the DARPA challenge.
Right.
If they actually had technology.
So it was a DARPA challenge, but they were not by DARPA. It's not seen by DARPA, so it should have been easy.
Correct. But, you know, a lot of what those videos that you say are, you know, pretty free to actually.
That's
pretty good. Some of the other stuff you see that you provide control on.
How will AI make us more normal? Peter, you got a follow-up question.
4 minutes and 8 seconds.
Yeah.
All right, I'll try and keep it to 30 seconds or something. So, many of the things that we do that are bad for us, bad for humans, are for the reasons that we are human.
is basically fear. We do things out of fear. We do things out of ignorance because we don't have enough of the facts. We do things because our reptile brain kicks in, our emotions, our egos, whatever, get in the way. Because we don't think that clearly, we don't think that well. So a lot of the mistakes we make, that's really important. Immoral things like bad for us and bad for other people. And anyway, we will suffer from these limitations, these not nearly as much as we do. It's not going to wreck our fear, it's going to have more knowledge. It's going to be, you know, some kind of a reptile brain that wants to just, you know, write in the literature or whatever. And it's going to be able to think much clearer. And that will allow us to avoid a lot of the things that we consider immoral.
Thank you. Excellent question. This one is probably excited about this question. It goes to Josh because he's in England. What experiments does Josh propose intervention researchers should prioritize?
That was my second and last slide that I didn't get to. Thank you, Patrick. We have a bunch of things that extend lifespan in mice, and presumably in human by a few percent, 5%, maybe 10%. We have a dozen of them. So you add them all up so you get 100% life extension. But it doesn't work that way. A lot of them are working on the same pathways that are redundant. You add 10%, 10%, you get 11% if you're lucky, 8% if you're not so lucky. How many people here are taking more than one supplement today? Yeah, and how many of you know what the interaction is among those? We don't know. The studies haven't been done. So my favorite, the experiment that I've been pushing for is to take 1,300 mice and give each cage of mice, just a few mice, combinations, every combination of three from the 15 best anti-aging treatments, and see among those combinations of three, is there any that synergize? They add 10%, 10%, you get more than 20%. Occasionally that's going to happen. And we don't have that really good statistics for this. We're looking for the outliers. So a few mice on each one will do it. So my proposal hanging out there is to use 1,300 mice with each of the combinations of 15 different treatments taken for three and apply. In other words, the different combinations of the
three. What are some of the
things? There's rapamycin, there's metformin, there's vitamin D.
Those are by those three specific.
We don't know what
but you
just
don't.
Okay, thank you very much. Excellent panel. Thank you so much for your contributions.